Once upon a time, in the land of Oz, there lived a girl next door, if ever there was.
Kylie's a Melbourne girl.
It's an Australian name and it means boomerang.
Yeah, I know she comes back here a bit.
Everybody's doing a brand new dance now. Come on, baby.
A fairy angel who was small and smiley, who everybody loved not a bit, but entirely.
She just went bang, bang, bang from looking like a cover girl and looking like a supermodel and looking like an actress, you know, and all these different things.
The girl next door, she blossomed and grew and brought her smile and her music to you.
You don't need to be a fan of her music to know who she is, and you don't need to be a fan of her music to like who she is.
Her flowing dresses turned into golden shorts. Her innocence turned into grown-up thoughts.
I remember when Spinning Around was released and the gold hot pants.
The perfect bum in the world, you know. Mm-hmm. Forget J-Lo, we've got Kylie.
She pulls off sexy, but in a canny way. It's not smutty at all. I don't know why. I think she's just so likeable.
Yeah. Slow.
She's a very distinctive voice, you can tell it a mile off.
She's just this down-to-earth girl who loves to entertain. That's what I think why she's been so successful over so many decades.
I don't think anyone knows how long it will go for. There may come a day where I think, OK, I'd really like to sort of stop and become a homebody.
We love the girl from Oz. Oh, yes, we really do. It's Kylie at 50, especially for you. In January 1988, Kylie Minogue burst onto the music scene with her first UK single, I Should Be So Lucky. It was an instant hit and was the start of a musical journey which has taken her around the world and back to the UK with her latest number one album, Golden. Along the way, she sold over 80 million records, had 7 number one singles and 6 number one albums, and a total of 34 top 10 hits in the UK alone, making her the third most successful female artist ever.
No one wants to stay at home, nobody wants to be alone. When you come knocking, I'll be at your door. I don't ever want to stop, I'm gonna give it all I've got. And when they ask me, who could ask for more?
We've actually got rhinestone cowgirl Kylie now. She's reinvented herself so many times, and it's hard to imagine that this is going to be the last reinvention.
But the whole scene in Nashville is huge now. We've got more and more country artists coming over, doing really well. So maybe she's ahead of the curve again.
The country and western idea and genre, it's not a new one. Obviously, it's totally camp. In a way, it's the most obvious thing for her to do.
She changed her style, she changed her musical direction, and she kept it changing and evolving. And I think when you're in the pop industry, it's important to do that because it's very easily forgotten.
Nashville's a great place. I love going there, but it's kind of like a bit seaside-y at the same time, you know? But if you go there, you're going to get involved with writing with country people.
The last album, Kiss Me Once, which was 2014, it didn't do as well as it could have. When it came time to record the next album, an A&R person at her label said, why don't you think about going to Nashville? She did 2 weeks of writing and just found it a transformative experience.
Kylie kind of looks more down home, real, rather than being all sparkling and, rhinestones, you know. But I think the country thing does suit her voice very well. And, you know, I mean, that's how Olivia Newton-John started, with doing country music. So I think probably that's what makes Kylie feel at home doing it. It's not too far out of her comfort zone. Never
fade away. I'm not a big country fan, and I saw the cowboy boots and stuff, and I was like, ooh, maybe a bit overdoing it with the double denim. But I love it. Such a good album, such a good album. I've got 9 copies of it so far.
One of the best things about Dancing for me is that it starts off as a song that sounds like it's about Saturday night. It's about putting on your best clothes and to go out celebrating with your best mates and have a good night out. But actually, it's more thoughtful than that. Like, I think the second verse comes in and she talks about being at the end of your life, looking back and being retrospective and thinking, when I go out, I want to go out dancing. It's not the fluffy pop song it presents itself to be.
You should probably do other stuff that's equally surprising to people. I don't think this sort of story's ended yet.
You're right, babe. The story hasn't ended. In fact, our story is just about to start. And for that, we need to travel back in time. Time. We travel to a land down under, Australia, where in the 1950s, a lot of British people became known as the £10 Poms, as that was the special price of the boat journey offered to Brits who wanted to start a new life on the other side of the world. Kylie Minogue's grandfather took up the offer and started a chain of events that would change the face of pop music.
They were always quite a showbiz family. Her mum was originally from South Wales and was and is a really good dancer. But she didn't want to become involved in showbiz. She was certainly good enough, but she settled eventually in Melbourne with Kylie's father.
Melbourne was the centre of music and the centre of the television industry at the time. And I think it's just because of its geography, it's a colder place and people are more interested in the arts here.
So she and her sister, they loved glitz and glamour when they were kids.
I think I have always been following this path because I started music lessons when I was about 4. I went to dance class, like jumping around in the tutus and things like that. I tried some tap, I tried tap, jazz, ballet. And my mother really wanted to introduce all of us kids to the arts.
Danielle was only 11 when she was chosen to do a song on Young Talent Hunt. Then, of course, she was asked to join the team.
Poor Kylie became the unofficial secretary of Danny's fan club. And she used to have to sit at the kitchen table and forge her sister's signature on all the fan mail she was getting. You can imagine her doing it between clenched teeth. And I think she probably got quite ambitious when she saw how well her kid sister was doing.
I wasn't a kid of 3 years old that said, I'm going to be an actor or a singer. I sort of fell into it by accident, really, and it's turned out for the best.
But Kylie's first taste of fame came from acting, not singing. Danny had an audition for the popular soap The Sullivans, but when it was decided Danny was too young, Kylie was offered the part instead.
I came here because I was tired and my leg hurts where I fell, and I can't remember the way to my Aunt Honey's.
The Sullivans was a World War II drama, and Kylie played Carla, a Dutch orphan, which is, let's face it, a difficult accent even for a season pro. Perhaps, luckily though, Carla was killed off after a few episodes, but she had put a tiny foot on the first rung of the ladder to stardom.
I was hungry. I'm sorry, sir.
It turned out Melbourne was a good place to be if you had show business ambitions, and Kylie soon found herself in another soap, Skyways.
My dad's a pilot.
Yeah, they're better than air traffic controllers.
Who says?
My dad's.
So did Mum.
This turned out to be special because the boy who played her brother in Skyways was none other than Jason Donovan. This is weird.
Bet you can't even fly a plane.
I bet I can.
Bet you can't.
What a charming young man.
But it wasn't long before Kylie got her next break on the Henderson Kids. She auditioned for director Chris Langman.
Well, I first became aware of her when we cast from the Henderson Kids. She was about 16, I think, at the time.
What do you think of that one? It's called A House on Fire.
Neat.
Might get one for the Rodeo Ball. If I can afford it.
Kylie was very shy in the beginning. We changed her look a lot. We gave her red hair, and the character she played was kind of a very working class, down market kind of girl who wanted to be a hairdresser. And so it was the chemistry of the time. She was just perfect for the part.
As far as her personality off screen, she's very shy. Kylie is very demure, and it's possibly one of the reasons why she's untouchable. Is because of that shyness and tends to sort of, you know, keep herself to herself.
We spent 12 weeks together on location, and it was quite clear that she was good at doing a lot of things. She was a good singer, as we know, and she was also a very good drawer, which I know she's very shy about that, but she's quite an accomplished drawer and a good actor as well, so she had it all, really.
Well, you've got to tell her yourself.
She's just a kid, Sha.
So tell her.
Well, I did already, sort of.
So how come she's still doing flag racing with you?
Well, I...
You've shown her how to do it.
Well, I promised I'd keep helping her.
Yeah, well, now she's all gooey-eyed over you.
Are you Dinkum?
Well, girls know these things.
She was always very natural and seemed to be able to do it with ease.
Kylie is the girl next door. She was when she was between 15 and 18. I always maintain that what she projects is the way she is. She's very honest in her betrayals in her performances, and I think that's appealing about her.
Kylie learned a hard lesson about the fickle nature of show business when she was written out of the second series of The Hendersons. But from the ashes of disappointment grow the golden wattles of success, and being cast in another Australian soap, The Zoo Family, was to be the last calm bit part before the storm of international superstardom.
Don't you like Susie?
I don't like being treated like a charity case. How come these hippos aren't in together?
They don't get along.
Who does?
People. Sometimes.
I hadn't noticed.
There was obviously something about Kylie from an early age that was instantly appealing. She had the K factor before it grew up into the X factor. But although the parts she'd been given on television were good, she was about to attend an audition that would turn her life upside down.
I can remember it very, very clearly when she came in to audition for the role of Charlene. She was this very sweet young thing, very shy. We ran the scene a few times, and I sort of glanced at the monitor, and I sort of went, wow, this is something here. She just came through that screen. Oh!
Charlene!
We love our soaps, don't we? Neighbours was just the biggest. Kids would get in from school, and it was on at just the right time to ditch homework and switch on the repeat of Neighbours. It was very canny because it was shown twice over here, wasn't it? It was shown at lunchtime when mums could watch it, and then later when the kids got home from school.
I got brought up on it almost every day. I remember it was about 5, 10 past 5 in the afternoon after we got back from school, we were having our tea, we had to watch Neighbours. And that was Kylie and Jason's era, so I knew all about that.
It kind of took over the whole country, really. They got kind of Kylie fever.
I was 16. I remember it very vividly, turning 16, and then the comparisons started. And I remember thinking at the time, is this a compliment? Because all I could think about was Charlene off Neighbours and the boofy hair and the overalls and the bogan.
Neighbours was big. When Kylie came along, it got bigger. So she made
Neighbours, but Neighbours made her as well.
It had become a popular show, but nowhere near as popular by the time Jason and Kylie came in. And, you know, credit where credit is due, Kylie and Jason had an awful lot to do with the popularity of the show back then.
Everybody was talking about them and the magical thing that they had together, this wonderful chemistry that they had that came through the screen. Everybody was just falling in love with them, and everybody wanted them to fall in love.
Neighbours became so popular that when Scott and Charlene got married, it was Australia's version of a royal wedding. 20 million people in the UK tuned in to see the King and Queen of Ramsay Street tie the knot. Stroth.
I think apart from Den serving Angie with divorce papers in EastEnders, it was the highest ranked soap opera episode of the 80s.
An equivalent to the population of Australia was watching the Scott and Charlene wedding that particular night, just in the UK. Well, unbeknownst to a lot of people, Kylie was a singer before she was an actress.
I think she always wanted to be a star. She is very smart about getting on in life. There was a charity show, and Kylie did a song, and she completely stole the show.
Mushroom at the time was the number one record label everybody in music seeked to get onto.
Dealing with us, an artist will get the best of both worlds. We're not too small to be able to offer them a real career, and we're not too big to not be able to understand their creative needs.
Mushroom Records saw an opportunity there to sell a lot of records on the back of her popularity in Neighbours.
Meanwhile, 10,000 miles away in London, a music production team called PWL were riding on a crest of a wave bigger than the ones on Bell's Beach in Melbourne.
The success of PWL Records is down to that. Three talented people there, Mike Stott, Matt Aitken and Pete Waterman. Yeah, this is the production team, Michael Kaczynski and Gary Astley, who are the two guys who ran Mushroom. And they asked Pete if he would produce Kylie. And I think he said basically no, but I'll send someone over to do it. So in the summer before Kylie came over to the UK, we sent a guy called Mike Duffy, who was one of our engineers, over, and he produced The Locomotion, the original version, which went all the way to number one in Australia.
It was hard to keep Kylie in for Neighbours with all the pop star side of her life happening.
She was trying to redefine herself as Kylie Minogue. Otherwise, she would still to this day be Charlene from Neighbours. He happens to have made a few records. At that point, no, we didn't think, oh, we're going to lose Kylie because she's going to go off and be a pop star. We went, yay, girl, you made a record. Yay, hope it does well.
I think it's absolutely essential for Kylie to leave Australia to become a big international star. Kylie had to come to the UK to make that step forward.
Locomotion stayed on the top of the Australian singles chart for 7 weeks and became the country's biggest selling single of the 1980s. Determined to make the most of this success, Mushroom Records decided there was only one thing to do: take Kylie to London to work with producers Stock, Aitken and Waterman. In October 1986, during a break from filming Neighbours, Kylie travelled to the UK to work with the trio of top writer producers who seemed to have the Midas touch. Everything they produced turned to gold records. Kylie just had a taste of success with The Locomotion, and now she was full steam ahead. She just needed to get on track.
We got known as the Hit Factory fairly quickly.
They were the producers of that age, I think, the 80s. Massive, churning out the big hits, this sort of early electronic sort of vibe and good songs. Really cool.
Pete was going for an 80s style Tamla Motown domination of the pop charts. Nothing left the building without Pete Waterman's approval. And he had the kind of ears where he knew, I would say 90% of the time, what was going to work commercially.
Stock Aitken and Waterman already had a track record. They had done disco with Hazel Dean, and they'd done a kind of camp new romantic song with Dead or Alive, and they had Bananarama, who were a massively successful girl group.
We were riding high with Mel and Kim, we were riding high with Rick Astley, mixing for the Pet Shop Boys.
Kylie helped them break through from being very successful kind of disco, slightly camp producers into pure pop top 10.
Nobody in the building knew anything about Kylie Minogue. We didn't know anything about Neighbours. None of us had heard of it. Pete had never heard of Kylie Minogue. It was just a girl in Australia that Gary and Michael wanted to do a single with.
But when Kylie arrived in London, Stock, Aitken and Waterman were not ready for her. And so, for a week, she spent her time sightseeing in London without ever seeing the inside of a recording studio.
And the day before she's leaving, Pete goes, we'll get her in the studio. We had a guy working for us there called Peter Pitstop doing disco promotions. And he was always queening it up every day. And when somebody said to him, have you got a boyfriend? He'd go, I should be so lucky. And Mike picked up on that, I should be so lucky, and wrote a song around that.
It took half an hour maximum for her to put the vocal on, I Should Be So Lucky.
Kylie had a nice voice, you know, and it was like teen, you know, it was a teen voice. Four on the floor bass, high energy, with simple lyrics that people could sing along to. Music for the kids. We offered it to 10 major record companies and they all turned it down. Every single one of them. And so we decided that we're going to put Kylie on PWF.
I remember Mike saying how impressed he was with Kylie's attitude, considering she's waited a week to do this. It took, one take pretty much.
Michael Hurl, who was produced Top of the Pops and Noel Edmonds' Christmas Day special, saw Kylie in Australia and he wanted Kylie on it.
So there we had the right record at the right time with a massive TV plug.
Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, Kylie waited nervously to find out if she was lucky or unlucky. Had the record gone into the UK charts?
I Should Be So Lucky was 31 and we had a career for Kylie Minogue.
I was constantly waiting for Kylie to do something new, but it just seemed like forever to wait when you're like 8, 9 years old.
Excusez-moi.
Yes?
Quelle heure est-il, s'il vous plaît?
It is half past six.
Thank you. I thought my watch was wrong.
The favourite promo I did with Kylie was a lesser-known song called Je ne sais pas pourquoi. And again, it was just Kylie and me. We decided that we would base it around a still photograph that was taken in France in the 50s. And it was kind of new for its time because we had to rotoscope her into colour and everything else in the background was black and white, which can be done quite easily these days. Kylie was very much the girl next door, and that was part of the persona that she brought with her from the Neighbours show, I guess. And she's just blossomed. Like each promo we did, she just got a little bit more adventurous and to become the way she is today.
Jealousy's a curse, you know.
Yeah? Well, so's having tickets on yourself. The only reason you sounded any good at all was because you had a damn good song.
One of my fondest memories was obviously when Kylie released Especially For You with Jason Donovan.
We had the mums and dads here because they liked the songs. They liked it because it's ABBA-ish. We had the kids here because that was a teen idol. And we had the gay fraternity over here. So we got the whole market.
There's not many artists that work together that do duets that you really feel the chemistry with. Everyone loved her. Everyone wanted to be her friend. Everyone wanted to buy her music. And she made her life and her romance with him very believable.
The irony was that their relationship, which they kept hidden until very late on, was actually on the rocks when they did Especially For You. But there you go, that's showbiz, isn't it? You wouldn't have known with the way they gazed lovingly at each other. The Stock Aitken Waterman era for Kylie was one of relentless success.
In the 4 years that Kylie was with Stock Aitken and Waterman, she had 20 hit singles and 5 top 20 albums, which together spent over 340 weeks in the charts. It was a brave pop singer who'd walk away from that, but helping her keep her courage and lending more than perhaps an ear was her new boyfriend, Michael Hutchins.
Well, commercially, Kylie was undoubtedly our biggest artist and the best thing that commercially happened for Peter Will. But she was caught up in that flow of changing from club DJ credibility to losing that and just being called pop.
I think it's natural for any artist at some point to want to have a more input. Michael Hutchins obviously lived a completely different life in a completely different world, completely different kind of music. Kylie was obviously interested in all of that, what was going on, because it was different.
Ever since Kylie and Jason walked down the aisle of Charlene and Scott in 1988 for their famous wedding in Neighbours, the world has been obsessed with Kylie's love life.
Kylie has had a lot of relationships, generally with men who aren't quite at the same level of fame that she's at, and sometimes that can be difficult.
I think the success, the brand that she's created, all of this that she does have, can come at a cost. All of your time and all of your effort, every kind of waking minute will go into how can I better myself. If all your time's going into that, it's inevitably taken away from somewhere else. And sometimes that is from your personal life.
That is one thing with Kylie that I can totally identify with, is that you do give up your personal life, your private life. And that was one thing I found very difficult.
I have a feeling that a lot of her boyfriends have been intimidated by being with such a powerful woman. The relationship I know of where she was really distraught when it broke up was, and I only know this because she told me while I was interviewing her, was with Michael Hutchins.
I think her relationship with Michael Hutchins was absolutely crucial for the development and the longevity of Kylie. He made her sexy because he was a rock star. She actually gave him celebrity, if you like. He became much more famous as part of a couple with Kylie Minogue than he was as the lead singer of INXS. As a couple, they were showbiz gold.
The relationship with Michael Hutchins was pivotal for her because he actually once said that his job in life was corrupting Kylie, and he did it really well.
He just was larger than life, but humble with it. And I met him at a point in my life where I was just ready to look at the world, and it was like he took my blinkers off.
She said something very interesting about that, and it was that Michael was not as bad as everyone said, and she was not as good.
We want Kylie to get married for real, don't we? But every time she seems to get close to being hitched, our relationships have broken down. This has led to the idea that Kylie is unlucky in love.
Of course, the press have always tried to paint the idea that Kylie is unlucky in love, because the press's objective of a successful love affair is that it ends in marriage and kids. I think that Kylie's approach is the approach a lot of gay men have, which is the fun that you have along the way, the romance that you find. She explores all of these themes in her music, you know, that life is to be loved.
Everyone's been a bit unlucky in love, in life. It's just that it's magnified because she's famous. So what gives us the right to say she's had a really rough time in love when we all have? Geez, I've been married before, engaged twice, I've got loads of ex-boyfriends. Does that mean I've been unlucky in love? No, it just means that I'm normal. Or I'm really picky. Yeah, or I just like getting engaged, who knows?
Now that's a whole programme in itself, Michelle. But she's right. Kylie may have had a lot of boyfriends, but who hasn't? It's not that she's unlucky in love, she's just Kylie. Kylie's second reinvention came in 1993, when having left PWL, she signed with Deconstruction Records. They were cool, they had street credibility, but would they know how to handle an Australian pop princess?
In the 90s, Kylie became much more culturally aware, if you like. She had influences that progressed her as a personality and as an artist. She wasn't just a disco, Stock Aitken and Waterman type star anymore.
Michael Hutchins was very influential in suggesting that she try different music. She might eventually have found her way there anyway, even without him, but he definitely gave her a head start.
When Kylie signed with Deconstruction, it was obviously quite a shift in the way that she was perceived in the media and her fans. She kind of had this new image, and it was very sexual and very sexy. But people evolve. We can't always be the girl next door for the rest of our lives. So I completely understood that change in her career path, and it only soared her anyway. She got bigger and better.
She released two albums on Deconstruction. Both of them, you could say they were passion projects. She followed her heart. They didn't really work out, though. She was experimental. She wasn't actually persuading serious music fans that she was okay to listen to. She was still kind of poppy Kylie in other people's eyes.
Towards the end of the 90s, Kylie's career flatlined, rather. It was very unfortunate timing when Princess Diana died, as well as being a great tragedy. Kylie had an album due out for release called The Impossible Princess, and what a bad choice of title that was.
Impossible Princess, and then it was going to come out at the same time as kind of die.
Very, very close after the tragedy, yeah.
You were in London at the time of all that?
Yeah, which I think is part of the reason I dropped the title. Because you can't imagine what it was like being there. It was insane. You couldn't step out the door and not feel presence, this somber presence.
It's very hard for anyone, if you're used to having number one records all the time, to then, you know, have any form of failure. When you think she'd had, by then, say, 6 years on that treadmill, it's hard. It's very punishing for anybody.
She really needed to do something as the 90s closed. Of course, let's not forget the tragic death of Michael Hutchins also had a big effect on her. Because, you know, she had loved him.
These days, that album for Deconstruction would be considered to be a big success. But in comparative terms, it was nothing like the four previous albums. Her way of dealing with it was, I think, almost, yeah, let's do something else. And fashion was an obvious move for her.
Kylie is so important to the fashion industry, not only because she's fashion forward, she's constantly that fashion chameleon that you're looking out for in sometimes what can be quite a bland, cyclical industry. And then you've got Kylie, who completely rips up the rule book, does whatever she wants, you know, really looks to the future to see trends.
When I think about Kylie, I think that she's literally got everything right. I don't think she's one of those people that follows fashion. I think fashion follows her.
The interesting thing about Kylie is, for all the sort of fantastical, massive show outfits, she never gets lost. It's always Kylie wearing the clothes and not the other way around.
Through all the decades, there's always a favourite look that I've enjoyed from Kylie, even at the very beginning with the album cover with the straw hat on and the hair coming out. So yeah, I think that's a great look. Even now, I think that's a fabulous look. I really loved her sort of reinvention, you know, the Lolita, the turning into a woman moment of the early 90s, which I thought was absolutely spectacular.
We've seen her grow up from this kind of girl next door, tomboy type character of Neighbours. We've seen her develop, go to as we get to the 90s and the noughties, kind of become a lot more assertive, more assured and flirtatious.
You know it's her. She's so distinctive. But she's gone through many different eras.
The whole showgirl moment, with, you know, with all the feathers and everything. I've seen all those shows, all of them. I'm a regular Kylie showgoer.
She knows exactly what her audience wants. She knows what she wants. And that's why she can get away with some of those, you know, the showgirl tour. That's why she can get away with that outfit, because it's fantastic. Just there on the floor, pretty much. I think the whole video, just on the floor, camera panning down onto her, and it was just, yeah, it was just amazing for me. Our eyes connected, no, nothing's how it used to be, don't second guess it. So it was that tableau of sunbathers. I think it was how it was just sort of the camera panned around, then panned in on Kylie. It was basically like one continuous main fashion spread, and I think it was really unlike anything the music industry had really seen before. Slow down and dance with me. Yeah. Slow. Kylie, on her tour especially, she's known for collabing with some of the biggest designers. Galliano, that whole tour Let's Get To It tour. It was quite a raunchy, quite a avant-garde costume. Dolce & Gabbana, you know, they're obviously long-time collaborators with Kylie. They go all out with her. And I think what's interesting, and Kylie herself has said it, with D&G, on a hanger, they might not look like anything, some of these costumes. For example, that's PVC baby doll sort of short mini dress with the boots, you know, which is in the Madame Tussauds outfit. It doesn't look like a lot on a hanger. You put it on Kylie and it just transforms.
I really met Kylie probably in the early noughties, and it was on her sort of comeback when William Baker began working with Kylie.
She just came in the shop one day and I bombarded her with like, just leapt over the counter straight away and was like, I've got all these ideas, I've got all these ideas, and showed her some drawings and stuff. And she was kind of like kind of looked at me in this kind of like vacant way and went, oh, cool, cool. I mean, this is Fee's original drawing here from the In Your Eyes video. If she went like that, the whole thing would gape. So we had to stick some double-sided tape over her nipples and stick some of the ribbons over her nipples. So it was kind of this extra layer, so it kind of all blended in.
I've always liked her fashion. I think she's got an amazing style. She doesn't really go wrong, but it's nice when she comes out there with something unexpected. You're like, wow, yes, girl.
The whole Body Language album, this was more mature, Bardot-esque. I mean, on that cover of the album, she's there with that cropped Breton stripe jumper. That really captured the mood of that decade. She really did sort of lead the way for that confident, sexy, she knows what she wants.
Can't Get You Out of My Head's one of those songs and videos that's going to go down in history. It was kind of groundbreaking because it was really simple. It just had that one white jumpsuit, which obviously had the slits and very low, and the hood. And the impact of something so simple was actually quite incredible.
This on a hanger would just look like a piece of white sheeting. I mean, not really anything. You put it on Kylie and it is just a feat of sort of sartorial genius. Kylie has no fashion misses because she's so aware of what she is and what she represents and who she is as a woman.
Well, I hope you got a few tips there. I know I did. I wonder if Primani do any of them. Anyway, go and make a cup of tea because after the break, it's my favourite bit of the programme. See you after this.
Kylie really is queen of campness, and we love her for it.
I think Kylie is quite probably a drag queen trapped in a woman's body.
She was the biggest news at the famous gay clubs around the world. There would always be Kylie nights. I think there was a famous, probably legendary story that she once rolled up to impersonate herself and didn't win. That sort of flamboyance, she started to incorporate into her own performance.
I think if Kylie was a thing, she'd be a sequin. If she was an animal, she'd be a unicorn. If, you know, she was a natural phenomenon, she'd be a rainbow. If she was a colour, she'd be pink. Like, her being of gay interest and having this big gay fan base just seems so natural. It just seems part of who she is as a person, not just as a music artist or an actress.
I think there's an element of accessibility that's quite important with her stardom generally, but there's something more nuanced and subtle when it comes to why the gays love her. I mean, she did the Mardi Gras in probably not long after that Spinning Around performance. She did the Mardi Gras in Sydney, sang ABBA in feathers. So she really pays homage to the pre-existing canon of gay icons. She seems really excited by that, and she seems to understand camp. And she always has a knowing glint in her eyes. She's quite cheeky. I think gay men love that.
I absolutely love playing DIY. And I love doing Gay Pride, headlining there. I love supporting the LGBT. And Kylie, they just love it. The more flesh, the better.
She just has really fun music, pop-tastic music. And all of my gay mates and myself, the best thing that we want to do when we go out is to dance to music we can sing along to.
Kylie's music was considered high-energy kind of music, and that's always been considered gay music. I mean, Hazel Dean had that market before Kylie, but of course, they were very, very happy to adopt Kylie as the new, high-energy goddess.
There's a sense of community within the LGBTQ plus scene that Kylie sort of pulls us all together. And even though, times may be hard, Kylie's there in her sparkles and spangles, giving us a good time.
One of the most famous examples of her support for the gay community is that she had two guys kissing in her video for All the Lovers. And it was suggested to her, or suggested to the director, that the kiss be removed, otherwise it might not get played on certain stations. And this was probably going back 10 years, I think. So, the world was a very different place. And she refused to have that kiss edited out.
She never kind of rolled her eyes at anyone's lifestyle or anything, and I think she's kind of just been like a mentor or something for people.
She continues to support the community and speak out. The mere fact that she said she wouldn't get married in Australia until they changed the laws there regarding gay marriage is just sort of the tip of the iceberg. She is also a friend of ours and is there with us. And I think we really do feel that sense of family with her.
My core fan base has been my gay audience, and they've really been with me through thick and thin. And yeah, they are the ones raising the roof each night with the show.
At the end of the day, all that stuff doesn't mean anything if the music isn't good. And if she hasn't been putting out consistently strong music, whether it's pop or whether it's indie or whether it's dance, if all that material hadn't been there and the music hadn't been great, the gay fan base won't be there. People will follow an artist because at the end of the day, the music is great.
At the end of the 90s, after her disappointment with the deconstruction experience, Kylie really needed something special for yet another reinvention of her career. And she found it in the smallest pair of pants in the universe. Oh, and some good songs, obviously.
She suddenly came back with Spinning Around. She had signed to Parlophone, rather quietly, came back with this single, and the single was brilliant. It was written by Paula Abdul.
I think she sort of went back to her disco sort of dance route, but with a little bit more class, and just pushed it into the now then.
The absolute killer was the video. If Kylie hadn't made that video, then we could be talking about Kylie, whatever happened to Kylie Minogue?
I mean, we have to talk about that with the hot pants. And the story behind those hot pants is incredible. 50p, her friend got them for her. Not even a stylist, just picked up these hot pants. And then her stylist, sifting through the cupboard, was like, oh, how about those hot pants, Kylie? And then put them on. And I mean, now they're a piece of fashion history. I mean, you can't even touch them now. You have to use white gloves because they're in a museum.
That was when Kylie's bum became rear of not just the year, like every year. I mean, who didn't want that bum? It was sensational, come on. And those hot pants.
The derriere probably ranks as number one as an attractant. It is basically the oldest attracting part of the body in evolutionary terms. Going back millions of years, you could not see somebody's personality or even their face from 100 yards, but you could see the outline of their derriere. In formulating the ideal derriere, you have to look at the most important factors. So you're looking at the overall shape, that kind of pertness that defies gravity. You're looking at the condition overall of the skin. You're talking about various features which can be combined together fairly simply in a formula. That formula is S plus C times B plus F over T minus V. What these items mean are S is basically the overall shape. C is that really important distinguishing characteristic, circularity. B is the kind of bounce factor. It's the resilience. It's those internal muscles that make everything seem to defy gravity. F is that firmness to the touch. It has to be firm, but not soft. So it's a difficult one. T is the texture. V is that pertness. The pertness that means that it kind of is that lift, that healthy, youthful lift. When applied and applied broadly across the population, people score somewhere between minus 5 all the way up to 80. Kylie Minogue was the only person who scored 80. I have on record as the perfect bum.
Spinning Around brought her back in a really big way, but it was the next single and the next album which made her into Super Kylie.
I was put together with Kathy Dennis for 2 days, one weekend in 2000. And we came up with a couple of songs, and that was the second song we came up with, like, on the Sunday. And we knew it was cool. We knew we had something pretty good there. And the following week, I think I sent Kylie's A&R guy, Jamie, a cassette of it way back then. And he said later on, I wanted to come down and demo it. And,
And then she's fortunate to get offered that wonderful Rob Davis song, which you and I could have sung and it would have been a hit. You can't beat great pop records, and it's one of those great pop records. And it's her biggest record ever.
They wrote Can't Get You Out of My Head. So that was the moment where I could have dropped to my knees. Thank you. This song's so amazing. Before the song had even finished, I'd say 20 seconds in, get on the phone, say yes. Yes, we need this song.
When she demoed it, she'd heard it for quite a few months. So when she came in, she really knew it back to front, know all the lyrics and everything. And we just pulled it around with her vocally. That was all done in my little garage in Epsom. And we moved it around, pulled it around, used some of Kathy's vocal backings, but all Kylie's leads. And she did a couple of little extra-y bits on the end. And that was the master vocal in like a few hours one day. It's incredible having it just in the UK, but that was number one all over Europe and worldwide and stuff. So it's like mind-blowing, really.
She's always been really good at hitting the zeitgeist, and I think going from that sort of pop to disco and being very sort of, it was a very sort of cool, shrewd move.
Mm-hmm.
the middle of the Showgirl tour on the 17th of May 2005, at the age of 36, Kylie was diagnosed with breast cancer. The tour was postponed, and within days, Kylie underwent surgery and started chemotherapy treatment.
When Kylie fell ill with breast cancer, people were really concerned about it. And one of the things I really like about it is that she was completely left alone to recover.
We were in Australia. I was on a tour bus of Sydney. We got a phone call from our tour manager, Sean, telling us to come back to the hotel. So we did. We had no idea what was going on. And we were all brought into a room and we were told of her diagnosis and we were told that the tour was over.
You have to make a decision whether you are open about something like that with the public. But they're going to find out, I think, whether you like it or not. So you have a choice. You either let it go and they find out in time, or you say it in your own words and you can take control of the situation. And that's what I really admire, because that takes a strong woman to just come out and say it.
And you think someone like Kylie is invincible. You know, she's a superwoman, she's all of these things. And, you know, hearing that someone like that has cancer, it makes them so real.
When she had that cancer, she was so open and it was so, I think, you know, brought her a legion of fans and supporters.
I think sometimes people fail to forget that we are still human. We still bleed, we still have feelings, they still hurt. And we still do suffer through these negative experiences that we might go through. We are in a position to change them into a positive and help other people. And if anything, that is a gift.
When you talk about this so openly, other women, other men at home who are going through similar situations feel that connection and they realise that they're not alone.
That first tour back in 2006, it was bonkers. It was her comeback, so the crowd was absolutely insane. Everyone was up on their feet, like, clapping for, like, minutes before we could even start. It was really emotional. You could feel it. People were so happy to, like, have her back, you know?
I've done a lot of shows in my life, but I've never heard a crowd the way the opening night of the homecoming. They just didn't stop, and it was very emotional.
Clapping for, like, minutes before we could even start. It was really emotional. You could feel it. People were so happy to, like, have her back, you know?
I've done a lot of shows in my life, but I've never heard a crowd the way the opening night of the homecoming. They just didn't stop, and it was very emotional.
It is just Kylie. It's her own brand. It's her values that shine through in everything she does.
For us at Marie Claire, Kylie is and always has been a really important celebrity and figure. Kylie has got real clout when it comes to shopping and shoppable clothes and what people want to buy. It's a real coup if Kylie wears your brand.
She has done so many. Cars, perfume, lingerie. She's done everything.
Oh, Kylie, babe, you should have made them bottles smaller. That'll never get in my handbag.
Well, the first thing I did was a Eurostar ad in Paris when she was still perceived as a homely, fun girl next door. I wanted to shoot it a bit like a sort of French film, handheld, relaxed, sort of documentary style. We just wanted it to feel like a very effortless, fun commercial. Obviously, wanting people to think going to France on Eurostar is an effortless, fun thing to do. then the Argent Before Couture thing was a real, quite a departure, showing another side to her that was much more sexy and unexpected.
Argent Provocateur is the most erotic lingerie in the world. And with your help, we can prove it.
Sex sells. It always has and it always will. And she's used it very cleverly.
I think she's a strong, independent woman.
She looks classy when she does it. Nobody seems to mind if she's got her bottom out. Nobody seems to think it's anything wrong when Kylie does it. It's always with a wink.
One of the first viral videos that got apparently 360 million views.
She's panting and gasping, and it's all very sexual and pornographic almost. But it's kind of fabulous because she's a woman using her sexuality. And so power to her.
Would all the men in the audience stand up?
Why do people love Kylie Minogue? She's an icon. She's been around for such a long time now, although she hasn't looked like she's aged today.
I am a big Kylie fan, yes, indeed. Loved her since the early 80s.
She's like a pop princess.
She stands the test of time. She's been around for longer than I've been alive.
I don't know how old Kylie is.
She looks about 30, doesn't she?
Yeah, exactly.
I was going to say 40, but she doesn't look in her 40s.
She's a superwoman, so she's had an amazing body for like 30 years.
Three words to describe Kylie, I would say...
inspirational.
Fabulous.
Fun, bubblicious, fabulosity.
Where's she from?
Is she from Australia?
No. Is she not born in Australia?
Kylie, of course, is from Australia.
Beautiful voice, the best, most positive energy. We love Kylie.
Over her 40-year career, Kylie has been nominated for over 300 awards and won 172. Now, I can't list them all because that would take another 40 years, but they include a Grammy, 3 Brits, 17 Arias, 16 Australian Logies, 1 Ivor Novello, 4 MTV Awards, a New Now Next, 1 Q, 1 Smash Hit, 1 Variety Club, 2 World Music, and Kylie was made a Knight of the Order des Arts de Lettres, pardon my French, for her contribution to the enrichment of French culture. And in 2008, Kylie was given the OBE by Prince Charles. And the pinnacle of success was reached when she became a judge on The Voice. So there we are. Of the 50 years Kylie's been on this planet, she spent 40 of them in show business and 30 as the perfect pop princess. She's been cute Kylie, sexy Kylie, indie Kylie, grungy Kylie, dance Kylie, and now rhinestone Kylie. But the one Kylie she's never had to reinvent is Smiley Kylie. For most of her life, regardless of what's been thrown at her, she's faced everything with a smile and has given everything she can for her ever-growing legion of fans. As someone famously said, the love you take is equal to the love you make. Kylie, we love you.
I think we love Kylie. She's still that pop princess and always will be.
Wanted to be her, I think. She just epitomised perfection to a 9-year-old girl.
She's an A-lister, she's a global superstar.
Now, I'm a huge Debbie Harry Blondie fan and Madonna fan, and Kylie kind of comes into that bracket.
She appeals from 5 to 105 and every genre in between. Yeah, there's not many artists that can do that.
Everyone loves Kylie. Men either fancy her, gay men just idolise her, and women just think, I want to be her.
I think she's inspired a lot of women. She was ill and then she came back stronger than ever.
She exudes this warmth and love herself, and so she gets it back.
She's brought a lot of happiness, I'd say, to the public. I mean, everybody goes, oh, Kylie, we love her.
I don't think Kylie will ever hang up her hot pants. I think she's a born performer. I think she's truly herself and truly happy when she's on stage.
I can never see Kylie retiring, and I think that is inspirational.
She's made her own future and made her own music, and that's why it's worked.
I saw a recent concert and her genuine enthusiasm and enjoyment of delivering the music to her audience still comes through.
I never look too far ahead. For me at the moment, it's less about going forward and just kind of running forward. I feel like I'd done that for years and years and years. Now I'd like to go a bit slower, but look at the view. I actually want more out of life. I really do.
From Kylie songs to ABBA songs and a perfect end to the weekend. She's terrible and she's getting married. Muriel's wedding is next.